Sabbath School and those who are joining us online. For our first song, let's sing hymn number 388, Don't Forget the Sabbath. Hymn number 388.
Marching to Zion, hymn number 422.
Join in the song with sweet.
song, we'll sing 590, Trust and Obey, song number 590.
Good morning and happy Sabbath to all. In Isaiah chapter 43 verse 10 says, You are my witnesses, declares the Lord, and my servant whom I have chosen. With this beautiful word, I would like you to welcome you for the Sabbath School program. Thank you.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, everyone. Today our scripture reading is taken from the book of John, John 8 verse 12. I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of life. John 8 verse 12.
For our opening song, let us all stand and unite our voices in singing hymn number 272. Give me the Bible.
Let's pray. Thank you, Jesus, for giving one another Sabbath day in our life. Lord,
cutters and polishers and do whatever is needed. Father in heaven, we praise your name forever. Lord, bless the children who all are participating in the Sabbath school program. I ask in Jesus' name, Amen.
Hello.
Yes. Good morning and a happy Sabbath to each and every one of you here. The topic for today's feature talk is Be a Light. First off, what is light? Light is a type of electromagnetic radiation that allows a human eye to see or make objects visible. In the Bible, light has always been a symbol of holiness, goodness, knowledge, and wisdom. In the book of 1 John 1 verse 5, it says, God is light, which means that God is a part of a system that provides light to the whole universe. The word of God is often compared to light. When one turns on a light, darkness is dispelled. Truth exposes error, trickery, and deception. It calms, settles, guides, and directs us into the right path. In Psalms 119, verse 105, it says, Your word is a lamp for my feet, a light to my path. Light is something that is necessary to navigate this world of darkness. We need light to guide us safely through the unforeseen dangers that awaits us. With light, it leads us through a straight path. It cleanses one's heart. The Bible uses the image of light to offer us a deeper understanding of God's gift to us in Jesus Christ. The complete contrast between light and darkness helps us better in understanding the gift of God's light and the grace Jesus Christ brings to our dark and sinful world. Spiritually, to walk in the light means to be faithful in our Christian life. The light of Jesus Christ guides us through the darkness of sin, life, and struggle, both spiritually and literally. Jesus is the light of the world, as proclaimed by Isaiah 49, verse 6. But he would commit the treasure to those who follow him. We can't see our future, direction, or destination, but Jesus can. Like the lighthouse guiding the ship, Jesus directs us towards God's light. Therefore saying, You are the light of the world, Matthew 5, verse 12. How important is light in our lives? Light is essential to our health, and it regulates our sleep-wake cycle. It can also help with our daily routines. It keeps you energized and up with your concentration level. It helps you spread positive vibes. Being a light to others also means responding with kindness and understanding. If you come across a person who is not interested in hearing your words of encouragement, God did not teach us to force his word upon others, but to teach it gracefully and with compassion. Like the song goes, I would like to be a light, a star, a candle in the dark. Give me my hand to give my heart and give the very best you are. May God bless all of us. Thank you.
be small, but we can help, like Jesus, by reaching out with kindness and lifting those who need us with small and simple faith, burning brighter every day. We're learning from the scriptures and choosing to obey. We're growing in His footsteps and trusting when we pray. We will follow
Check. Good morning and a very happy Sabbath, everyone. Our mission report for today comes from Guinea. It's about a boy named Theophan, and the story is entitled as Choked by Unseen Hand. Something frightening happened to Theophan as he was getting ready to go to school. Someone grabbed his throat. He couldn't see who had grabbed him. He was very terrified and ran to school. After some time, he was able to breathe normally again. He would feel an invisible hand closing his throat and cutting off his air supply. Gasping for air, he would find a place where he could breathe. Theophan's father took him to many doctors, but the doctors could not find what was wrong with him. So he decided to take him to a psychiatric hospital, and the physician prescribed him some pills. But the pills did not stop the attacks. It was at the low point when a voice spoke to him, saying, "Go to church." Theophan did not understand. He had stopped going to church a year ago. But the attacks kept coming and coming, and the voice kept saying to him, "Go to church." He wondered whether God was trying to communicate with him. Theophan's uncle was a Seventh-day Adventist. He came to visit. He said to him, "You should come to Adventist church for prayer." The next Saturday, Theophan and his uncle went to church. He was filled with an inner peace that he had never experienced before. At every meeting, people prayed for him. They asked God to stop the demonic attacks. As time passed, the attacks grew less and less. Theophan realized that church was very important. The doctors could not save him, but Jesus saved him. He gave his heart to Jesus and joined the Seventh-day Adventist Church.
Thank you for your 13th Sabbath offering 3 years ago that helped a Seventh-day Adventist school expand with a new classroom in Conakry, Guinea. Hear the rest of Theophine's story next week. Thank you for listening and have a blessed Sabbath.
Thank you.
pray.
Let's pray. Dear God in heaven, thank you for your presence this morning. Thank you for all your love and care. Help us to be a light to reflect your character. Bless us to be a blessing for others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. Let's do this again. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
That's better. I really want to thank the children and the department people for taking up the Sabbath school. And as usual, we will disperse for our Sabbath school lesson.
Uncle, they're asking for two mics.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. We praise God that we are together in this lesson study. And this week at Spicer, the theme our children have been presenting to us, be a light. This goes very well with our lesson, being a light for God, sharing God's mission. And today our lesson is, as Dr. Varikan has pointed out, excuses to avoid mission. What are some of the excuses that we give to avoid mission, to escape from what God is calling us? The memory text is taken from Isaiah chapter 6, verse 8. Isaiah 6, verse 8. Also, I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send, and who will go for us? Then I said, here am I, send me. Isaiah 6, verse 8. Here am I, send me. As we begin our lesson, let's compare for a moment Jonah and Isaiah. What was the response of Isaiah? Who will go? And the response of Isaiah was, send me, Lord. I will go. Very positively. But what about Jonah? what about Jonah? The response was not very positive. We all know the story. Jonah, God told Jonah to go to Nineveh. And Nineveh was, Jonah had to travel east to go to Nineveh. But Jonah decided he would go west. He would go west. It would take for Jonah 1 month to travel from where he was, from Israel, to go to Nineveh. It would take 1 month journey. And 1 month by foot. But Jonah decided to go west and by sea to Tarshish. I want to ask our class today, why did Jonah decide to go in the opposite direction? Why did Jonah decide to go in the opposite direction? Against God's word. And so my question is, what was the spiritual level of Jonah, in your opinion? Spiritual level of Jonah? Or what was Jonah's relationship with God? In your opinion, you'd say on a low, medium, or high, in your opinion. When God called Jonah and told him, go to Nineveh, what was Jonah's relationship with God? Would you put it on a scale, low, medium, or high? Dr. Varekan, give us your opinion. When God called Jonah and said, you go to Nineveh.
I believe when God called Jonah, he must have looked around the world and found Jonah to be the man to go. And so I believe that his relationship was very high. But from the time he was called, it began to go down.
Very interesting. When God called Jonah, his relationship with God was high. And after the call,
it just began to slide down.
Began to slide down. Very, very, very interesting. I want to know the reason why you think it was sliding down. Any other opinion? What was, in your opinion, how was Jonah's relationship with God? And I want to come, sir, I want to give you at the end. Okay. But yes, sir, I want to ask anyone else. What do you think? Jonah's relationship with God. Yes, sir. In your opinion, because this is just we are seeing. You think it was low, medium, or high? Sir, what about your answer? Jonah's relationship with God.
His relation, he was a human being with his weakness. But the main thing is that Nineveh was a very wicked city.
Nineveh was a wicked city,
very,
yes, sir.
Very wicked. So he didn't want to go there. That's my opinion.
Thank you, sir. Jonah did not want to respond. Sir, let's go to Dr. Sanjeevan.
When we talk about the level of Jonah, definitely, as Dr. Varekan said, it was high. And I want to compare Jesus with Jonah.
Amen.
Jesus and Jonah both were called for a mission.
Amen.
This was the job given to them by God. And definitely, they had very high esteem in the sight of God. But the difference is, Jonah had fear. And that is the only reason why he went in opposite direction. But remember, even Jesus had fear. When he was in the Garden of Gethsemane, he prayed and said, Father, if possible, let this cup turn away from me or take this cup away from me. But here is the catch. After this request, Jesus said, not my but thy will be done. Which Jonah did not do. He did not ask God to do his will, but he chose the opposite direction and went. And therefore, even though we are on a very high level with God, our relation with God is very close, but it is not unnatural to have fear. All of us have fear. Humans have fear. Jesus had fear. But what we do after the fear is most important, and we have a lesson to learn from the life of Jesus. Even if we have fear, we need to say, not my but thy will be done. And if we say that, God will shower his blessings and he will give us the ray of hope to carry forward and onward to do his mission.
Amen. Amen. We praise God. Let me make a response. Thank you, sir, for that beautiful comparison between Jonah and Jesus. We need to bring in Jesus. Jonah was from a place called Gath-Hepher, which was very close to Nazareth, which means Jonah and Jesus, they come from the same area, from Galilee, from Nazareth. And Jonah. Jonah was sent to a wicked city of Nineveh. We are coming to, we will describe Nineveh in a few minutes. And Jesus was also sent to another Nineveh. And we are that Nineveh. To this earth. We praise God. We praise God that Nineveh is in God's plan. You are in God's plan. I am in God's plan. I really praise God. Jesus came willingly. He came to his own. And in contrast, when Jonah went to Nineveh, the response was overwhelming response. From king to the lowest person, the response was very good. They put on sackcloth, fasting, including animals. What a response. How I wish our response was also like the response of the Ninevites. I really praise God. But still, the bottom line, dear friends, is Jesus, just as God loved Nineveh, God loves each one of us. I don't know if you are doubting God's love today. If somewhere you're thinking, because of what's going on in your life, you're saying, God, are you really with me? If you are doubting God's love today, this lesson is telling us, God is telling us, you are special to me. I am there for you. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid of the darkness. Don't be afraid of that crisis. Today, God is assuring us that he is watching over us. He is listening to our prayers. I really, really praise God that Jonah and Jesus are very similar. Go ahead, sir.
I just want to add a comment here. I said the relationship between Jonah and God were very high. Mm. Because I find in the Bible, when God calls someone, it is always someone who is hardworking and who is willing to do.
Amen.
That's the kind of people that God always calls. He doesn't call lazy, idle people. Mm. Number one. When I said the relationship began to slide, God's relationship with us never changed. He is an unchanging God.
Amen.
The relationship begins to break down and we slide down because of us, because of the choices that we make. We read in the story of Jonah. Jonah went down to Joppa. Jonah went down from Joppa to the bottom of the boat. Jonah went down from the bottom of the boat to the bottom of the sea, to the belly of the fish. You see the spiritual slide of Jonah's life here? If you want to go down, God will let you go down to the bottom until He brings you up. You see? So, the relationship with God is broken, not by God. It is always us.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you for these beautiful points. Yeah. Jonah was going down and down. His relationship. It was Jonah that moved away from God and moving into a mess and going deeper into that mess. Where is God? Where is God? He is also moving with us into that mess. He is not far from us. God was with Jonah in that storm. God was with Jonah as he was thrown into the sea. What a God we have. He will not leave us in our storms, in our mess. He will not leave us in our darkness. What a God we have. If it is one of us as parents, or if it was one of us as teachers or as leaders, if a student is going into the mess, if a child is going into the mess, yeah, he didn't listen to me. She didn't listen to me. Let her go down. But our God, He goes with us, into our entanglement, because He is the one who alone can untangle us from that situation. And He will navigate that mess with us to bring out Jonah from that situation. I really praise God. And I began to wonder this week. Jonah's spiritual level was very high when God called him. And then it began to slide. And I began to think this week. Please think with me. What if God did not call Jonah to go to Nineveh? Because by this time, Jonah's spiritual level was high. Because Jonah was in a wider ministry than just what the book of Jonah talks about. Please come with me to 2 Kings chapter 14. 2 Kings chapter 14, verse 25. The man was a prophet in Israel. And he was speaking to the kings. Please, 2 Kings chapter 14, verse 25. He restored the territory of Israel from the entrance of Hamath to the Sea of Araba, according to the word of the Lord God of Israel, which He had spoken through His servant Jonah. Jonah was guiding kings. Jonah was ministering in Israel. His spiritual level was very high. And God calls. God calls when your spiritual level is high. I really praise God. And that calling is to raise that spiritual level even higher, not to low. God calls us to make us even more stronger. I praise God. And as I wondered this week, what if Jonah was not called to Nineveh? You minus that storm. You minus that going into the belly of that fish. You remove that experience of preaching in Nineveh. What would have happened? What would have happened? We would have missed some rich spiritual lessons. I want to believe, and I want to share with you, my friends, Jonah was on a spiritual high in Israel. But Jonah experienced his true conversion when he was on God's mission in Nineveh. Truly converted. Because only the truly converted can frankly speak about their weaknesses. Because this book was not, the book of Jonah was not written by somebody else. It was written by Jonah himself, a first-hand account. And he outlines all his faults, actually. It's embarrassing. But because Jonah experienced the true conversion, I really, really praise God that God took Jonah to Nineveh in spite of his reluctance. Some Bible scholars, they call the book of Jonah, or in looking at this story, they say, a reluctant prophet to a repentant people. People are responding positively to God. But here, a reluctant prophet, unrepentant prophet actually, to a repentant people. What a God we have, who is willing to work with Jonahs like us, who is also willing to work with the Ninevites. This story tells us that God has no partiality. I want to ask you, dear friends, what is your Nineveh? What is your Nineveh? What is your Nineveh? Is this call only to prophets? Is this call only to people of that time? Has God changed? No. This call is for all. Not just people of that time. God is sending calls. As he called, as he sent a friend request to Jonah, as he sent notifications to Jonah, God is still sending. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And this call is not just to prophets or to mission workers. God's call is to all. This is not just to older people. God's call is to every age group. And today, what is your Nineveh? What is your call? What is God calling us to do? And what is your Nineveh? Let's look at, we are looking at these excuses. Why didn't Jonah want to go to Nineveh? And our first excuse the Bible, our lesson gives us is fear. Let's look at what the Bible says about Nineveh. Okay, if you are on Jonah, chapter 1, verse 2. Nineveh, God speaks to Jonah. Chapter 1, verse 2. Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city. So Nineveh was a great city, a big city. And our lesson gives us the information that Nineveh was a big city, because cities were usually on a hill or on a mountain. And we know of the cities are small. Jerusalem is a small city. Babylon is a small city because they have to put a wall around it. It's not easy in those days. But Nineveh was comparatively a magnificent city, a big city. And the structure of Nineveh was octagonal. Octagon is eight sides, like a prism. So Babylon was a square. New Jerusalem a square. Length, breadth, height is a square. Same. But Nineveh was very beautiful city, octagonal, eight sides. So it was a great city. Nineveh was not only a great city. Let's go to Nahum, talks about Nineveh. Please, just one or two books after Jonah. Let's go to Nahum, chapter 2, verse 8. It's about Nineveh. And Nahum came later, several decades after Jonah. So Nahum was a later prophet. And Nahum writes, Nahum chapter 2 verse 8, though Nineveh of old was like a pool of water. Okay, let's drop down to verse 9. take spoil of silver, take spoil of gold. There is no end of treasure or wealth of every desirable price. What do we get out of this? Nineveh was a rich city, full of gold and silver and treasures. Nineveh was a great city, a rich city. And we also see Nineveh, let's go to Nahum chapter 3 verse 1. Look at the Bible description of Nineveh. Nahum 3 verse 1. Woe to the, what does your Bible say? Woe to the bloody city. Nineveh was not only a great city, a rich city, it was a bloody city, which means there was bloodshed, rebellion against God. It was a godless city, a bloody city. And you can see it is full of lies and robbery. Its victim never departs. The noise of a whip, the noise of rattling wheels, of galloping horses, of clattering chariots. So Nineveh was a bloody city, which means the people of Nineveh were rebellious, very cruel. They were given to violence and they would kill. Really, Nineveh was a great city, a rich city, a bloody city, a godless city. And Nineveh was the capital of the great Assyrian Empire. And the Assyrians were known for their cruelty, extremely cruel, cruel city. And I want to, if you make a comparison between Egyptians and Assyrians, Egyptians were far better. Or Babylonians were very kind. Medo-Persians were very tolerant people. But the Assyrians, very cruel. Because the Assyrians' philosophy was, they had a strategy. If they conquer any kingdom, if they conquer any kingdom, any nation, their goal was, it must be wiped off from the map. Must be wiped off. And we see, not during the time of Jonah, but about five, six decades later, an Assyrian king, Shalmaneser, he came to Israel, the nation of Israel, the 10 tribes of Israel. He conquered, killed, bloodshed. Those who survived, he took them as captives to Assyria, to the nations that they have conquered, and sprinkled these people in those nations. Why did they do that? Why did the Assyrians do that? So that these people, these survivors, will never be able to come back together and form their nation. So cruel. So cruel. Egyptians were not like that. The Babylonians were not like that. The Medo-Persians were not like that. The Romans were cruel, but not like that. The Assyrians were pictured to be very cruel. And so Nineveh was a bloody city. And so we can expect Jonah to have that fear naturally. How can I go to this cruel people? But he was a prophet. And prophets are expected to be courageous. Nathan was a courageous prophet. Went to David and he blasted the bomb to David. But he did it wisely, very tactfully, Nathan did. Here was Jonah, was afraid of that city. So any other excuses that are coming to your mind? Why didn't Jonah want to go to Nineveh? Our lesson talks about the second reason on Monday's portion. The Bible, our lesson talks about false views. Jonah did not want to go to Nineveh because of false views. What is that false view that Jonah was holding? that he was using it as an excuse. You know, today, if you go to some villages in India, and at the entrance of the village, we see the god of that village, the temple for that god, which means the gods are territorial gods. The same idea was existing then. Because when the Philistines came to make war with Israel, and when the Philistines defeated Israel, what would they say? We have not only defeated the Israelites, but also the God of the Israelites. Territorial, the God of the Israelites. So when people went for war, it was not just the people going for war with their enemies. They were going for war against their gods as well. And so this idea, the false view that gods are territorial. And so Jonah may have had this idea that the God of Israel is only for the Israelites. It's only for the Israelites. That the Ninevites, then the people of Nineveh, the people of other nations are not part of God's plan. The Syrians had such an idea. Please come with me to 1 Kings chapter 20, verse 23. 1 Kings chapter 20, verse 23. You see this idea, this false idea about gods. 1 Kings chapter 20. We see the Syrians were coming for a war against Israel. And this battle between the Syrians and the Israelites took place on a mountain. Okay, on a mountain. And the Israelites, they won. The Syrians were defeated. And now they are making an analysis. What happened? What went wrong? Why were we defeated in spite of our strategies? Please see the answer as they were talking. 1 Kings chapter 20, verse 23. Then the servants of the king of Syria said to him, they said to the king of Syria, their gods are the gods of hills. Their gods are the gods of hills. And so, because this war took place on a hill, their gods are powerful. Next time, what are they saying? Let's go. Their gods are gods of hills, therefore they were stronger than we. But if we fight against them in the plain, surely we will be stronger than they. Do you see this idea, my dear brothers and sisters, that gods are territorial? Is our God territorial? Hallelujah. Our God is the God of the mountains as well as God of the valleys. We have nothing to fear. Yes, sir.
Yeah, we say that, but then I think many times in our real life, we do different way and we act differently because we think God is here and God is not there. And that's why, just like Jonah, we become fearful. We don't do many things because we are afraid. We are afraid of them because we forget that God is also there. You see? Why was Jonah running away to Tarshish? Why didn't he want to go to Nineveh? It is that wrong concept that God is not there in Nineveh. God will not be there in Tarshish. If I run away, God will never find me. That was what Jonah thought. Because this is what the idea. God is here, but God is not there. I can run away from him. I think this is such a great lesson. Why are we fearful? Because we don't know God enough.
Thank you for that beautiful point. Do we know our God? Are we limiting our God? Are we limiting his strength? Are we making a wrong estimation of our God? Today, dear friends, God called Jonah to Nineveh because it's not just the people of Nineveh that God wants to reach. It is even Jonah that God wants to reach. Because every one of us are valuable to God. Because God is not partial. He is not territorial. What a God we have. And did Jonah believe that God would forgive the people of Nineveh? Did Jonah believe that God would forgive the people of Nineveh? Yes. Go ahead, sir.
Yeah, he did, because that's what he told God. I told you so. I think that was a prayer that is there in our lesson also. Beautiful prayer. But he told God, didn't I tell you? Okay. I knew this was what was going to happen.
Can we go to Jonah chapter 4 verse 2? Jonah was upset with God. When God chose to show mercy upon the people of Nineveh and spare that city. Friends, God is in the business of sparing people. He is in the business of sparing families, sparing cities. God spared Nineveh. And God wanted to spare Sodom and Gomorrah. What a God we have. Today, God is sparing your family. God is sparing your life because He has a purpose. And we praise God that in Nineveh, the king at that time was Adad-nirari III. And archaeology tells us that there was a revolution in Nineveh, a revival in Nineveh, a reformation in Nineveh, in this wicked city, bloody city, in that cruel city, there was a revival. What a God we have. I want to, please let's read Jonah chapter 4, verse 2. So he prayed to the Lord and said, Our Lord, was not this that I said when I was still in my country? Therefore, I fled previously to Tarshish. This was my original reason why I was running away to Tarshish. For I know that you are gracious and merciful God, slow to anger, abundant in loving kindness, one who relents from doing harm. What a picture. What a beautiful picture of our great God. Today, if you are doubting God because God did not answer your prayer, or there is a delay in answer to your prayer, you prayed for something and it appears as if God is not talking to you, no message from God. It appears as if heaven is shut on you. Here is the message. God, you are slow to anger. You are full of compassion. Abundant in loving kindness. One who relents from doing harm. What a God we have. Jonah knows that God is going to show kindness to Nineveh. Yet, not want to go. Because Jonah he didn't want to be misunderstood as a false prophet. As a false prophet. Jonah was interested in his honor than God's honor. Someone comes to you and says to you, please pray for me. I am sick. Are you going through some stress? What if I pray for healing and she's not healed? What if I pray for him and he is not healed? What will he think of me? What will she think of me? What will this family think of me? Are you afraid to pray for the healing of someone? Go ahead, sir.
See, I think this experience of Jonah is so profound and beautiful in our personal spiritual life. Jonah failed to see what God is achieving through him. God took him from a stiff-necked people to a repentant, willing people. I am very sure the 120,000 people that repented was much larger number than ever in his own country. He was not accepted. We know from the history of the children of Israel that the children of Israel always reject prophets. But here, the so-called heathens accepted him. I believe that Jonah was not accepted in his country, but I believe he became the Hall of Famer in Nineveh. And I believe that the 120,000 people in Nineveh and around Assyrian country talked about Jonah. That's what God did with Jonah. But did he see that? He failed to see it. Many times we fail to see what God have achieved and can do through our life because we tend to look myopic view of what we can do, what I can do, and what God has failed. This is where the problem is. Look at Jonah's life. Where did God take him? And what did he achieve through his life? He became, and that's why he is there in the Bible, because of what God did with Jonah in Nineveh. Otherwise, he would never be here in the Bible.
Praise God. We praise God. I can imagine in my mind, when all the saints go marching in, so many from Nineveh would be thanking Jonah. Thank you for visiting us. Thank you for your message. Even though Jonah preached reluctantly, went there reluctantly. I'm sorry, it's not that he preached reluctantly. He preached with all his heart. Many, as the saints go marching in, they will say to Jonah, thank you. Thank you. Today, you are the Jonah. I am the Jonah. God wants to do great things through your life. It's not great things in the sight of the world, but great things in the sight of heaven. You may be saying, I cannot speak. I cannot give a Bible study. I cannot go somewhere. Please, let's not have a short-sighted mission of God. God can do. If God is impressing upon your heart, if God is impressing upon your heart, pray for that auto driver. Pray for the shopkeeper. Pray for that neighbor. You're looking through the window of your house. You see a young lady walking. And God, Holy Spirit is telling, pray for that person. Pray for that man. Pray for that young man. Pray for that child. Please. Do it. No excuses. I'll do it tomorrow. I'll do it later. If God is impressing upon your heart, take. Buy a Bible. And give it to your neighbor. Please do it. Don't say, next time. Or if God is impressing upon your heart, cook a meal and just take it to your neighbor. Please don't give excuses what they will think of me. One day, a friend of mine called me and said, I just came into this city. I was in Hyderabad at that time. He said, I brought my mother for an eye checkup. And same time, another friend came into my house. And I told him, so-and-so came into the city. Yeah, we brought his mother. I said, let's go and visit. And my friend said, let's not go empty-handed. Let's cook a meal. My wife was in school. And so both of us, we cooked a meal, lunch, prepared lunch. And I went on my two-wheeler to that hospital, long distance. We went, taking that meal, lunch for my friend and his mother. And we called, he was not answering. But we can find him in that eye hospital. We searched, call was not going through. Finally, a little after 2 p.m. in the afternoon, call went through and he said, we finished our business. We're going back on the bus. We felt disappointed. And I told my friend, let's go back. And we were going back, and Jack caught an idea. You know, this is just, let's take 10 minutes. I know of one of my church members here, just by the side of the road. Let's since we are here, let's pray for him. No, it's lunchtime. It's not a good time to visit anyone. It's after 2 p.m. This is not a good time, but let's go. My friend said, let's go. We went, and we saw that member, his young sister and a younger brother, three of them in that house. And I said, did you have your lunch? They said, yes. But you can see their faces. And I'm like an older brother. I doubted. I just walked into their kitchen. Saw everything was clean. And I doubted. Said, we brought some food. Please take it. And so we put in the dishes. And we prayed as we were about to go. That brother, he came out. And he said, thank you for bringing that food. We didn't have lunch today. Our gas was over. We were waiting for the cooking gas. When God is calling us, this is not a big mission. Big things that God is asking. Last night we saw, our children taught us last night, how you and I can be a light while playing on the playground, in the football field, on the road, helping someone carry their bags. This is what God is calling us. Little responses that God is looking for you, from you and from me. Dear brothers and sisters, God is calling us. Let us not give excuses, because every mission, the primary purpose of God sending you on a mission to a neighbor, to pray for a neighbor, is not just the salvation of the neighbor, but your salvation and mine as well. What a great God. Jonah was converted in Nineveh. I really, really praise God. Let me close with one thought. Friends, everyone in the book of Jonah obeys God. Willing to obey God, except Jonah. The wind, the storm, the sailors on the ship, the captain says, please pray. Everyone willing, crying to God. And then the fish brought out Jonah very safely. The people in Nineveh obeyed God, including the king and the plant, the worm. Everything obeys God except Jonah. But we see God's love, God's mercy, God's compassion for Jonah. How I wish when we have miraculous experiences, when Jonah was brought out of the belly of the whale, he came out of the belly of the whale. The word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time. Such experiences are life-changing experiences. How I wish Jonah was fully converted after that. He was converted. He became obedient to some extent. But later, he had his own baggage. God is calling us to mission, to remove that sinful baggage from your life and mine. I don't know what is that sinful baggage you are carrying today, whether it is pornography or lust or desire for something. Please, God wants to pull that out. Let me close with Titus chapter 2, verse 11. Please come with me. You have to look at this. Titus chapter 2, verse 11. I hope you can find that small book, a letter of Paul to Titus chapter 2, verses 11 and 12. For the grace of God, I hope you are there, 2 verse 11. For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, means mankind. Salvation for all, Babylonians, Israelites, Egyptians, Ninevites, everyone. God is not partial. Grace of God brings salvation to all. Verse 12, teaching us. What is the purpose of the grace of God? Bring salvation. To give salvation for you and me. And what else the grace of God does? Teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in the present age. Verse 13, looking for the blessed hope and glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. Come out of those worldly lusts to live soberly, righteously, godly in the present age. I don't know what is your Nineveh and what excuses you may be giving today. I want to say, like Jonah, let us respond, because Jonah was fully converted in Nineveh. May God help us. May God guide us, that you and I will be like Isaiah saying, here am I, Lord, send me. Whether it is a small assignment, God, you're giving me, or a big assignment God is giving me, giving you, respond to God. Here am I, Lord, send me, I am yours. Let us pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we want to thank you for your grace, your mercy, the grace of God for the salvation of all. Father, at this time, we dedicate each one of us. Father, you want us to send us to our Nineveh. May we respond like Isaiah. Here am I, Lord, send me. Whatever it is, it could be a little kind word, a prayer, doing something little for you. Because little is much in your hands. We dedicate each one, Father, that we'll be faithful to the mission you called us in this week. Help us, Lord, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Please read next week's lesson. Very interesting. Preparation for mission. God performs miracles in our lives. But if we are thinking only of miracles, if we are depending only on answered prayers and miracles, that is dangerous. One day we will doubt God. But God has a plan to ground us in our spiritual life. And so that secret is found in next week's lesson. God bless you all. Thank you.
Thanks so much. Happy Sabbath.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, everyone. I welcome each and every one of you and those who are joining us online. To begin our divine service, let's open our hymns to hymn number 526, Because He Lives. 526.
Let's all sing 530, It Is Well With My Soul, 530.
Straight. Good morning and happy Sabbath, Church. Happy Sabbath, Spicer Church. That's more lively. We thank God for His grace and mercy through the past week. And today we are here celebrating the Sabbath, celebrating the goodness of God. And as we do that, let's take a moment to ask the Lord to be in our midst so that whatever we do in His presence would glorify His name. Revelation 22 verse 17 says, "Come, says the Spirit and the Bride. Come, let's each hear a reply. Come forward, you who are thirsty, accept the water of life, a free gift to all who desire it." The living water, the God Himself, is in our midst, so let's accept Him as we worship Him today. We have a few announcements, kindly take note. The Sabbath weekend, as you have witnessed last night and as you see this morning, we have our little children, the children of our church, who are here to remind us the words of Jesus that, "Truly I say to you, unless you turn and become like children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." So those of us who are here to look at the little children leaders in our worship service, those of us who are here to encourage our children to minister unto the Lord, let's be reminded that unless and until you and I become like children, the kingdom of God is not going to be for us. These are some serious words of the Lord. But let's learn to be like a child as we worship Him in innocence, in truth, and in honesty. And we are very grateful for all the children of our church for the wonderful program that they have prepared for us. We also would like to thank the leaders and the officers of the children's ministry who have taken a lot of time to get our group of children together to lead us in our services today. May the Lord bless them, and may the Lord bless all of us as we worship Him. An announcement for the students who are planning to go for the Indian Youth Conference. This conference is starting from November 8 to 12, 2023 in Bangalore on the theme From Glory to Glory. Those who are yet to register, please kindly do so. And the registration fee for the students is 900, while for the working professionals, it's 1,200 rupees. And an announcement for all these students who have already registered. If you have registered from Spicer, please note that you will have a short meeting right after the AY service this evening. If you have registered to go for the IYC from Spicer, please note that you will have a short meeting right here in the House of Prayer after the AY service. The beautiful flowers that adorn our church this morning are a contribution from Mrs. Rebecca Gaikwad in thankfulness to the Lord for His blessings and guidance throughout the last year. We are glad that the Lord has blessed her with another year of life, and may the Lord keep you as you celebrate your birthday, and thank you for the beautiful flowers that you have given to us today. The communication department of our church would like to take pictures of all the newly elected church department leaders and their associates soon after the worship service. So all the newly elected officers along with your associates are requested to gather in the church lawn right in front of the church for the pictures. We have our Sabbath afternoon appointments. Kindly take note. The baptismal class for the youth of our church will meet at 4 p.m. in the House of Prayer. The AY services will be led out by our children this evening, and this will be held at 5 p.m. in the House of Prayer. The master guides will meet at 2:45 p.m. next to the administrative building this Sabbath afternoon, while the adventurers and the pathfinders will meet on Sunday morning at 8 a.m. next to the administrative building. The lay activities department are going for house visitation this Sabbath, and those of you who wish to have the members visit you at your places and pray with you, kindly reach out to the pastor so that we can forward your names to the lay activities department so you can have a visitation from the church. The women's ministry, all the women of our church, you will have your meeting at 4 p.m. in the newly constructed building next to the church. And this meeting is held in order to practice for the AY service that is assigned to the women's ministry. So those of you who are interested, do join us at 4 p.m. in the building right next to the church. We have several prayer requests, kindly take note. Let's continue to pray for the nations of Israel and Palestine as they go through the disrupt and the riot that's happening between the nations. Let's pray for both the nations. Let's ask the Lord's intervention so that there would be peace among both the nations. Let's continue to pray for the family of Mr. Robert Daniel as they grieve the loss of his dear wife, Mrs. Susan Robert. She passed away on October 29, 2023, and she was laid to rest as well. The family would like to thank the church for all the prayers offered on their behalf for her, for the dear family member, and they would like to ask the church to continue to pray for them as they grieve the loss of Mrs. Susan Robert. Let's continue to pray for our brothers and sisters who are seeking prayers on their behalf. Mrs. Omana Krupalayam, she is doing so much better now, but she thanks the church and continues to ask the church to continue to pray for her. Mr. Raju Rai, he's better and he's back with us. We thank the Lord for his mercies. Mrs. Marchila Tudu, Abide Sabo, Mr. Navratan Mins, Mrs. Ripnar Pamthid, Mr. M.J. Prakasham, we have heard that he already passed away, so let's continue to pray for the grieving family. Mrs. Alice Murmu, Mrs. Tanpui, Mrs. Anju, Mr. Mallik Arjun, Mrs. Saroja Tambi, Mr. Ching Pong, Mrs. Jill Charles, Mrs. Linda. Let's continue to pray for them. Mr. Kingsley would like to thank the church for all the prayers offered on his behalf as well. He's better, he's doing so much more, he's doing so better comparatively from before, and he still has a long way to recovery, so let's uphold him in our prayers as well. The Sabbath, as we continue to worship the Lord together, let's be reminded of the words that we have received in Isaiah chapter 42, verses 10 to 12. Isaiah 42, 10 to 12. Sing a new hymn to Yahweh. Let his praise resound from the ends of the earth. Let the sea and all that it holds sing his praises. The islands and those that inhabit them, let the desert and its cities raise their voices. Let the inhabitants shout from the mountaintops. Let them give glory to Yahweh. And today, as we witness our little children worship and glorify God, let's unite our voices. Let's pray for them so that the Lord's presence would be glorified. God bless all of us as we worship him.
Thank you. Dear Lord, on this holy Sabbath day, you have called each one of us to be the light. Jesus is the light we know, and we are to reflect Jesus in our lives. May this be our aim in our life. There's a prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
For hymn of praise, let's sing song number 93, All Things Bright and Beautiful. Song number 93, All Things Bright and Beautiful.
Check. Before we start our kneeling prayer, I like to read one verse. 2 Chronicles 7 verse 14. It says, if my people which are called my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and heal their land. The congregation is requested to all kneel down. Those who cannot, they can sit. Our most gracious Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the wonderful blessed Sabbath that you have given us. Thank you so much for the freedom of worship in your holy place. Thank you so much for the shower of blessings for each and every one of us. Thank you so much for the food, clothing and shelter. At this time, I like to pray for the sick and suffering people among us. Touch them with your healing hands so they may get cured and be grateful to you. At this time, I like to pray for the growth and development of the Spicer University. Be with the leaders of this institution as they lead the great institution. Be with them and guide them. At this time, I like to pray for the peace in Israel, Palestine, and Ukraine and Russia. At this time, I like to pray for the speaker of this hour. As he is going to break the bread of life, touch him, touch his lips so that he may deliver your message. We ask this few blessings in the name of Jesus. Amen, amen, amen.
Proverbs 3 verse 9 and 10 says, honor your God with your wealth. Honor your God with your wealth and with the first fruits of all your increase. So your storehouses will be full of grain and your vessels will be overflowing with new wine. With that thought, I would like to invite all the people with special offerings and tithes to come forward. The deacons to come forward and collect our offerings. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for giving us this Sabbath day and for all the blessings you have given us. We pray that you will bless all the people here in this church and for those who are not able to be present. We pray that you accept our humble offering and use it for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray, Amen.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, everyone. For today's scripture reading, the speaker has chosen from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 5, verses 14 to 16. Ye are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, and it giveth light unto all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. May God bless through his word. Amen.
Thank you.
Can we all say amen to this beautiful song that was sung by the children? You are the light of the world, be a light. Can we all say amen to it? Amen. Thank you, children, for this wonderful song. Just seeing them up here gladdens each of our hearts. Be the light. Be the light. That's the topic that has been chosen for this morning by the children's ministries. Last week, the church pastor sent me a message on WhatsApp informing me that it was my turn to speak for the divine service on this theme, Be the Light, as it's going to be Children's Week and in church. And I began to think why I was given this important task. I remember last year too, for the Children's Week, I had been given this opportunity. So it's the second time that I'm speaking on the Children's Sabbath weekend. Preaching a sermon to children isn't an easy task, as the attention time span of children isn't very long. Also, you need to keep them engaged in different ways so that they continue listening. But more than that, I believe that children imitate their elders, they copy them. So being a good example worth emulating is what elders need to practice to help keep children stay on track. You cannot bluff a child for long. Yes, when a child is small, we tend to make up stories to put them to sleep, but they catch on quickly with their endless questions. Be the light is our theme today. But last night when the children were up on stage, I saw the backdrop theme reading, Be a Light. Again, I began to think, is there a difference to be a light and to be a light? To be a light and be the light? And if there is, then what is the difference? Our Bible text that is chosen for today is taken from the book of Matthew chapter 5, verses 14 to 16, and it reads, You are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, and it giveth light unto all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. Some years ago, I worked in one of our schools in North India in a small town called Hapur. One thing that caught my attention was the line written on the building facing the road in big, bold letters. You are the light of the world. I really liked it because that's what we are. As Christians, we ought to be light to the world. The word light is mentioned 433 times in the Bible, and there are 235 verses or passages about light. If we were to read each verse now, my sermon would be complete. But I just want to focus on a few verses which I feel is sufficient for our food for thought today. I want to ask any child seated up here to respond now. Children, what was created on the first day? Light, that's right. What was created on the fourth day? Fourth day? Sun, moon, and stars. Yes. What does the sun give us? Light, right. Okay? So, the first day we have light, and on the fourth day also there is light. Genesis chapter 1, verses 3 to 5, it reads, "And God said, let there be light. And there was light. And God saw that the light was good. And God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning the first day." Now, why did God create light on the first day? He could have created anything else. The fact that God created light on the first day is something that is very significant. It was the light of God's presence on this earth. Because on the fourth day, we see that God created the sun, the moon, and the stars. Again, we see that these celestial bodies give us light. But this light is different from the light that God created on the first day. It's difficult to understand this complexity, but the fact is that light is essential to dispel darkness. Light is responsible for all life, for the production of the air that we breathe, the cycles of our oceans, for the magnetic fields around a planet, gravity, warmth, and our weather. In the Bible, light has always been a symbol of holiness, goodness, knowledge, wisdom, grace, hope, and God's salvation. God's revelation. By contrast, darkness has been associated with evil, sin, and despair. John chapter 8, verse 12, it reads, "When Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, I am the light of the world." Jesus has been referred to as the light of the world. It's said that he's the source of light, which is evidently the goodness and hope that we need in our faith. Across cultures, light is an ancient symbol of understanding and intellectual thought. It is the opposite of ignorance or darkness. Almost universally, the dark is considered to be frightening and sinister, associated with things that we cannot understand. Light is said to conquer darkness and to bring order out of chaos. To be the light means in times of darkness, you offer hope, encouragement, kindness, and compassion. In times when others are struggling, you offer a way to help them to regain their glow and shine. To see the good and the beautiful, it is in this that that truth is re-established. To be the light may be to offer wisdom and guidance, or just to sit with someone and be the presence they need. It may be offering strength to those that are in a moment's weakness, or offering a smile and joy to someone in random parts of your day. When I think of being the light, I think of my favorite smile and how it makes me feel. I think of the ways other people have helped my heart to glow even brighter than it has in the past. From a kind word that is said, through encouragement, through a smile that is given, or a joy that is shared. In deeper relationships, it is through the physical touch of someone, the love that is shown, and the intimacy that is present. Sometimes, to be the light means to carry the torch for what needs to be completed or to be made new. It means to give of yourself in a new way to a situation or cause or relationship you are in. It may also mean to just be still and show that nothing really needs to be said at a given time. until the time is right. To be the light is to foster peace and to show others the joy that is present. It also means that you try to protect your flame from being blown out, so that you can be the light, and so the light remains. In all truth, beauty, and goodness, we are the light. In times of trial and struggle, it means to illumine what is wonderful. This is not always an easy task. Sometimes we can find it beyond difficult to be the light. But in these moments, when we focus on what is divine, we are more able to be the light. In concrete reality, being the light may be loving someone despite their flaws. It may mean helping people through situations that they do not know how to overcome. It could be empowering others to overcome whatever they are facing. It could be holding someone's hand so that they can feel love and know it to be real. Or smiling at a person you are in love with just because you are in love with them and adore them. It could be reaching out to that person you have not talked to in a long time, to let them know you care and that they have value and worth, to let them know that they are not forgotten. It may be to radiate joy and celebrate the blessings that are present in life. A story is told about a lighthouse keeper who worked on a rocky stretch of coastline and who received his new supply of oil once a month to keep the light burning. Not being far from shore, he had frequent guests. One night, a woman from the village begged some oil to keep her family warm. Another time, a father asked for some to use in his lamp. Another needed some to lubricate a wheel. Since all the requests seemed legitimate, the lighthouse keeper tried to please everyone and granted them all. Toward the end of the month, he noticed that the supply of oil was very low. Soon it was gone and the beacon light went out. That night, several ships were wrecked and lives were lost. When the authorities investigated, the man was very repentant to his excuses and pleading. Their reply was, "You were given the oil for one purpose, to keep that light burning." We are called to keep the light burning. Think about Jesus' time. In his day, they did not have artificial lighting as we have today. We have different kinds of ways to light up an area, but Jesus' followers never understood the present lighting system. They had oil lamps in Jesus' time. Every house had an oil lamp. You can see a lamp right here. It's not an oil lamp, but something that has caught my attention, and I'm sure it has caught your attention too. A wonderful, beautiful lamp here. The five wise virgins and the five foolish virgins all had lamps. But the foolish virgins did not carry enough oil with them. So when their lamps went out, they were lost in the darkness. Yes, you are the light of the world. You are the light of Christ to the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hid. Nor does anyone light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand, and it gives light to all who are in the house. I want you to read the verses above carefully. Pay especially close attention to the words, "You are." In the same way, let your light shine. and that they may see. When you put emphasis on those words, what happens? I mean, what message do you get? I'll tell you. You get the clear and definite message that being a light is not an option. Jesus doesn't say, if you choose to be a light, or I really hope you will let your light shine. He says, you are the light and that you have a responsibility to let it shine for the whole world to see. Yes, the whole world. Not just the people you go to church with, not just to the people in your neighborhood, everyone. And here's how he expects you to do it. Know God's word. Several years ago, Leonardo DiCaprio starred in a movie called Catch Me If You Can. It was about a person, a man, who was a con artist and a master of deception. He fooled people into believing that he was a doctor, a co-pilot, and a lawyer. He was able to fool people for a while, but he had to keep running because sooner or later the truth came out. Every single time. The same is true when it comes to being a light for Jesus. You can't be his light if you don't know him. Really know him. You might be able to fool people for a while, but your light won't stay lit once you run out of people to fool. Additionally, if you don't truly know who Jesus is, what he expects, how he thinks, what is his truth, your light won't stay lit. You can't claim to be the light of Jesus if you don't use Jesus to fuel that light. Live God's word. If you wanted to make a chocolate cake but insisted on using oatmeal instead of cocoa, it won't be a chocolate cake, would it? Even if you used everything else the recipe called for without the cocoa, it just wouldn't be right. Likewise, if you are going to be the light of the world, Jesus calls us to be, you need to know it's an all or nothing thing. Your light can't be switched on and off. It is meant to burn 24/7 all the days of your life. Share your light. A light does absolutely no good if it doesn't illuminate, if it doesn't reveal what is there to be seen. To be the light, Jesus calls us, and it requires us to reveal the truth of who Jesus is. To be light means we love as Jesus loves. Show compassion and mercy as Jesus shows compassion and mercy, and hates sin the same way Jesus hates sin. To be the light of Jesus means we light the way for others by sharing the truth of the gospel with as many people as possible. By living life with a genuine Christ-like attitude, by supporting missionaries, and by treating the world around you as your mission field. You will be the light Jesus has called you out to be. If you have accepted Christ as Savior, being a light isn't an option. It's a command. So, get out there and shine. Jesus shed his blood for us and is naturally a giver. Just like him, we need to give wholeheartedly. Giving doesn't always mean money or actual gifts. You can bless others by giving your time, volunteering, helping someone in need, or having a conversation. These are all opportunities to shine God's light. Share the gospel. Another great way to be the light of the world is by sharing the Bible, which is full of light and truth. Encouraging and lifting others up is a wonderful thing, but nothing is more powerful than the Word of God. The Bible is the only book that can share the ultimate light of Christ. By sharing the gospel, we share the light inside of us. And it helps us show others who the true source of light really is. This is a wonderful opportunity to help someone who is lost and walking in darkness find the Lord. There are so many ways outside the church to share the gospel. As always, seek the Lord and pray for His guidance. Give thanks in every circumstance, even during life's challenges. This is what also shines the light of Christ through you. Sometimes we are the only Bible others see. Sometimes we are the only Bible others see. We can share the gospel through the way we talk, live our lives, and through our actions. The way we love and our attitude says a lot about who we are and who we follow. People may see you facing a difficult time in your life, but yet you are still full of light and joy. They will wonder how you are getting through times so difficult, and they will desire to have what you have. Your light will shine. You can also shine the light of the world by practicing and displaying humility. Serving others is one of the ways we can serve God. It is having an attitude of servitude. Just like Jesus displayed the perfect example of humility by washing his disciples' feet. It's important for us to stay humble and to always try our best to do the right thing. Have unwavering faith. Reflecting Christ and the light is not always an easy road. Trying to shine the light of the world will be evident to our enemy. Evil doesn't want the light because the enemy knows how the light can overpower and outshine the darkness. The more we shine the light and reflect who God is, the more the enemy sees as a threat to him. The enemy is always lurking around. He will try to destroy the people who are really following the Lord and reflecting his light. It's important for us to always keep our eyes fixed and focus on the Lord, to put on the full armor of God and to be ready when the enemy starts knocking on our door. It's not about if, it's about when the enemy will attack. We must be so focused on Christ that our faith is unwavering. Loving and trusting the Lord should be something we work towards every day. Trust helps us stay focused and keeps our eyes open. Satan will try his best to destroy the light of the world that you shine by using tactics. Some are easily hidden. But God expects and empowers us to keep being the light. We must stand firm on the foundation of Christ, and His word will help us not to get distracted. Don't hide your light. Hiding it from the world doesn't do any good, and it certainly doesn't stop the enemy either. Don't let the trials and tribulations you are experiencing cloud your light. The spark of the light shines the brightest when no one expects it. Be the light. I've made an acronym, Be the Light. It says B, believe in the goodness of God. E, for empathize with your fellow men. T, tell them the truth. H, honor elders. E, exemplary life, example to others, be an example to others. L, love others. I, have integrity. G, give till it hurts. H, humble, be humble. And T, be trustworthy. Take a candle and light it. When we take a candle and we light it, what happens to the candle? It consumes itself in order to give light to others. Jesus is the light of the world. He sacrificed his life for you and me, and in doing so, he's dispelled and defeated darkness and gained victory over sin. If you want to be the light, you too ought to sacrifice yourself, your time, your energy, your love to help others and show them the path to eternal life and light. Yes, Jesus is the lighthouse. And as we listen to this song, okay, we can see that Jesus, okay, the lighthouse that stands amidst the rough and rugged sea. There's a lighthouse on the hillside that overlooked life's sea, when I'm tossed it sends out light that I might see, and the light that shines in darkness now briefly lead us all. If it wasn't for the lighthouse, my ship would be no more. And I thank God for the lighthouse. I owe my life to him, for Jesus is the lighthouse, and from the rocks of sin he has shown a light around me that I might clearly see. If it wasn't for the lighthouse, tell me where would they ship be? Everybody that lives about us says, tear that lighthouse down. The big ships don't sail this way anymore. There's no use of it standing around. Then my mind goes back to that stormy night when just in time I saw the light. Yes, the light from that old lighthouse that stands up there on the hill. And I thank God for the lighthouse. I owe my life to him, for Jesus is the lighthouse, and from the rocks of sin he has shown a light around me that I might clearly see. If it wasn't for the lighthouse, tell me where would they ship be?
For the song of congregation, let us all stand and sing song number 492, Like Jesus. 492, Like Jesus.
Bow our heads for prayer. Our dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for this beautiful day you've added into our lives. Thank you for all the blessings you've given unto us. Help us to be a light and to be a light. As we part our ways from this church, guide us throughout this day and lead us away from harm and dangers as we go our ways. In Jesus' precious name I pray, amen.
Dearly beloved children of God, the Lord bless you and keeps you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace as we walk out of this house of prayer until we meet again. Amen.